is head of digital assets at Swissquote Bank, based in not so sunny Geneva today. But we've got a good webinar for you, so hope you're all ready to enjoy it. We've got 21Shares to talk to us about lots of information around Ethereum and decentralized finance, obviously an extremely hot topic at the moment. So we'll hear from them in a moment. Before that, I'll do a very brief overview of who Swissquote are and who I am. So first of all, kicking off with myself, head of digital assets at Swissquote. I've been here for 7.5 to 8 months now. I started my career in fixed income and FX sales and trading in investment banking, mainly in London, including working at a hedge fund. I then started my entrepreneurial journey back in 2008, a long time ago now, especially in the e-commerce side, built a few businesses. I started working with data centers and other ad hoc type projects, really enjoyed that. And then I sidestepped, went to Babson College in the US. I was number one in the world for entrepreneurs. Learned a hell of a lot about the entrepreneurial mindset in America, brought all of that back. And hence, since then, I've been in like lots of innovation, running European innovation at Fidelity Investments, building a crypto custodial solution. And now I'm with Swissquote, running digital assets. So who are Swissquote? For those of you who don't know us, we've got 9 offices globally. We're largely Swiss based, but we've also got offices in Luxembourg, London, Dubai, Malta, Hong Kong, and Singapore. Over 400 million total equity. The core capital ratio, I think it's actually a bit higher than 20.8. But yeah, it's 21%, very high relative to the other banks. Most of the other banks, or in fact, all the Swiss banks are lower than us. So that's really cool. And we've obviously got institutional assets of about 34 billion, always going up as well. Global presence I've covered. And if you need any contacts at Swissquote, more than welcome to reach out on these forms or contact myself or Stefano or anyone else directly. That is us from Swissquote side. It's now time to hand you over to Hany at 21Shares Amun, and he'll talk you through the presentation.
Hello, hello. Echoing Chris's thoughts, good morning, good afternoon. We are not too far away in Zurich, which is equally unsunny. So that's pretty exciting. We have a really cool topic to talk to you guys about today, and that is the rise of decentralized finance. And what is going on specifically on the Ethereum ecosystem. But before that, let me give you a little bit background on us. Joining us today from the 21Shares team are myself, I'm Hany Rashwan, one of the co-founders here, and I'm the CEO. And our two research associates, Lanre and Eli, are also on the line, and they'll be very happy to go through the Ethereum ecosystem and what's is going on DeFi right now. A little bit of background on the firm. Go back one slide. Let me share what we're going through today. So I'll give you a little bit of background on the firm, who we are, where we came from, what we've done so far. We're going to give you a bit of an overview on Ethereum, the second largest crypto asset. What makes it a little bit more programmable and manageable than Bitcoin, and what is causing DeFi or decentralized finance to be built on top of it and to be exploding in popularity. We'll finish off with explaining how you could be an investor and be part of this Ethereum ecosystem and all the innovations that we're seeing happening in the space. And then we will open up the floor for any Q&A if you have any. We would love to answer some questions at the end. So now a little bit about who we are at 21Shares. We're a Swiss-based company. We launched the world's first physically backed crypto exchange-traded product. We did it here on the SIX Swiss Exchange. Since then, we've followed up with a number of different products. If you could go to the next slide, perfect. We have by far the most expensive product suite in the space. We allow you to invest in Bitcoin, Ethereum, and four other single assets, three indexes, or an inverse, a short. So you could go the other way as well. Our aim is to make crypto as accessible as possible. So we work with a lot of family offices and private banks and independent asset managers, as well as a lot of retail clients to purchase crypto in a way that is as easily accessible as buying a share or a stock. We are listed on three major stock exchanges, the SIX Swiss Exchange, Deutsche Börse, and Wiener Börse, in addition to BX Swiss, Börse Stuttgart, and a few other smaller regional exchanges. We're also broadly available in USD, CHF, euros, and pounds as well. And so we give as flexible as accessible a platform as possible to be your on-bridge to the crypto world. With that, I would love to give it over to Lanre to talk a little bit more about Ethereum.
So actually, it's Eli. Exactly, no worries. So some of you may have heard of the name Ethereum, but do not know exactly what it is and how it is different from Bitcoin. And the objective of this presentation is to give you a concise overview of what Ethereum offers and why we believe at 21Shares that this is one of the most important innovations in the financial industry. So briefly, Ethereum is a world's computer designed to build decentralized applications with its own cryptocurrency called Ether. So entrepreneurs and companies building those applications pay Ether for the use of the world's computer. In other words, Ether is the fuel to the Ethereum platform. And at 21Shares, we like to call Ether the digital oil. So onto the next slide. To summarize, Ethereum is the world's computer or the platform. Ether is a cryptocurrency that serves as a fuel to the platform. And differently, Bitcoin is digital gold with a limit of 21 million, as you may know. So on to the next slide. Now, as investors, you must be wondering, what problem does Ethereum solve, right? So potentially, Ethereum has a total addressable market of all the industries that could build services and products on the internet. But financial applications are the most dominant on Ethereum, which I'm sure some of you may have heard of the term decentralized finance or DeFi. So DeFi is essentially a sector combining all these financial applications built on Ethereum, and they offer different use cases, enabling users to store, send crypto assets, or borrow, earn interest, and invest without a bank. And it's very important to note that these applications are non-custodial, meaning that these crypto assets are stored on the Ethereum blockchain and therefore controlled by the users. So all the great innovations solve real problems, and Ethereum is no exception. So with the current macroeconomic landscape that we're living right now of zero to negative interest rates and the lack of transparency in the traditional financial system, the DeFi applications brought to the market try to solve these issues, which are part of the building blocks of the third wave of the internet, from centrally owned and managed applications to applications built on decentralized protocols. So onto the next slide. Since the start of the year, the DeFi ecosystem has experienced a massive growth with almost 200 startups, billions of dollars of value transferred, and is disrupting markets such as trading, lending, remittances, and more. So this innovation provides 24/7 availability, auditability, transparency, and also reduces censorship, cost, and certain counterparty risk. But remember, none of this would be possible without Ethereum, and this is why Ether is the second most traded crypto asset and the largest crypto asset in the world, with a daily trading volume of more than $300 million, which is 8x that of the next competitor, alongside more than 600,000 transactions processed on the Ethereum blockchain, which is about 200x of the transactions processed by the next competitor. So onto the next slide, the closest analogy of investing in Ethereum is having ownership in the entire Silicon Valley ecosystem, where companies solve substantial problems with billions of dollars addressable markets. And investors across the world have started to recognize the considerable value of Ethereum with an exponential growth in its price since the start of the year of more than 180%, and a performance surpassing 200% onto the next slide, as you can see, since the wake of the COVID-19 pandemic, which is a critical test to see how Ethereum performs during uncertain times. So now my colleague Lanre is going to go through four important projects in the DeFi sector, which you are going to see onto the next few slides. Thank you.
Thank you, Elif, for that. So yeah, exactly as Elif said, we're extremely bullish on the long-term investment case for Ethereum. And part of the reason why Ethereum has, you know, performed over 200% since March 2020, and also being one of the best performing assets over the last few years in general, has been a lot of the building momentum that has been around what we call the DeFi space. And Ellie's talked a lot about Ethereum and kind of how Ethereum links to DeFi, acting as the fuel for the DeFi ecosystem. We thought it'd be extremely helpful to give a few kind of real life examples of exactly some of these main DeFi use cases and applications, so you can understand some of the early user traction around these applications and also where their long-term potential kind of lies. So as Ellie mentioned, I'll briefly touch on four different DeFi applications and then touch on some of the metrics which help show just how much traction there is around DeFi, even at this early stage. So I have four DeFi applications I want to touch on very briefly, and I'll just walk through each of them in turn. So first is Tether. And Tether, very simply, as it says on the slide, is a stable coin whose value is pegged to the US dollar. So using a create and redeem function for the stable coin, one stable coin on the crypto spot market will always be worth around $1. And the settlement and issuance process is carried out and facilitated totally by the Ethereum blockchain. And kind of as we'll talk about more on the next slide, kind of stable coins have been one of DeFi's biggest use cases and seen a lot of traction, whether they be for traders looking to trade in and out of a volatile asset like Ethereum to a non-volatile stable coin, or for people looking to easily move, you know, real US dollar value between countries in a kind of permissionless and decentralized way. And then secondly, we have Uniswap, where in contrast to centralized stock exchanges or centralized crypto exchanges, where there's a centralized and single point of failure and someone or counterparty one must, you know, trade in and out of, whether that be the New York Stock Exchange or Coinbase, a decentralized exchange allows users to transfer assets and various crypto assets based on the Ethereum blockchain in a decentralized way with no single point of failure and a total peer-to-peer way. So if I want to buy Ethereum very easily through my web browser, I can do that without having to rely on a centralized platform like Coinbase or the New York Stock Exchange or any other platform to get access to Ethereum, but can do in a totally decentralized way, in a similar way to, you know, how Bitcoin or Ethereum run in a decentralized way. And the third application is called Yearn Finance, which is an automated asset management platform. And again, this is decentralized and seen a lot of traction over the last year, despite only launching a year ago. And algorithmically and automatically, it allows investors within the DeFi to automatically move their holdings to the lending platforms, which will provide them the highest yields. So kind of like a yield optimizer based on DeFi. And this, once again, runs in a totally permissionless, open source and decentralized fashion, and is one of the key innovations we've seen in DeFi over the last few months. And then finally, we have Aave, which is a decentralized lending platform, which allows users to earn interest on assets which they lend out to others, and also allows users to borrow assets in a decentralized way. And obviously everyone's familiar with kind of lending, how important lending is for the financial economy in general, you know, mostly in the form of mortgages or business loans. But one core aspect of DeFi is the fact that it allows people to carry out decentralized lending. So lend to a counterparty, which you have no idea who that would necessarily be. And you don't necessarily have to rely on a credit score or a bank to facilitate this loan, but you can do so in such a decentralized way without necessarily placing your funds, your lent funds or your borrowed funds at unnecessary risk. And these all sound quite esoteric, but as we'll show in the next slide, these early applications have seen a lot of traction, and it's part of the reason why we're so bullish on Ethereum and DeFi over the coming months and the coming years. So I briefly explained these four different DeFi applications, and I just want to kind of, you know, explain a little bit more about why each of these applications is so promising for Ethereum and helps strengthen the investment case for Ethereum. So Tether, I explained, was a stable coin. And I think the best analogy you can think of, what in the traditional finance one could compare stablecoin to, a stablecoin such as Tether to, would be something like PayPal, for example. Many people are familiar with PayPal and use it to transfer money to people in foreign countries or get paid, whether in this domestically or internationally. And in Q2, PayPal saw about an average of $2.94 billion worth of daily transaction volume. Comparably, Tether saw $3.5 billion worth of daily transaction volume, you know, being about 600 million larger than PayPal. And this is despite the fact that PayPal, as many know, is one of the most, you know, successful and well-capitalized companies, financial companies in the world, the market capitalization of, you know, over 100 billion, which places it at a higher value than Ethereum, despite the fact Tether in of itself carries out more transaction volumes, and is only one of the only, is one of many stable coins that has been issued on Ethereum. And so this goes to show that, you know, objectively, something like a stablecoin has generated a lot of traction and use, which puts it at a comparable scale to, you know, even something in legacy finance. Despite the fact we typically think of DeFi and Ethereum as a very early stage technology, we have already found product market fit in something like stablecoins. And I think Uniswap is another good example of a decentralized application within the crypto space, which has already outperformed its centralized counterparties within the crypto space also. So many people that are familiar with crypto trading or are active in the space have heard of Coinbase, which is perhaps the most successful Western-based crypto exchange for people to switch their fiat currencies to crypto and vice versa. Currently, Coinbase sees around $200 million of daily volume. This compares to Uniswap's $260 million of daily volume, $260 million plus dollars of daily volume. And kind of this has been a phenomenon we've seen kind of appear over the summer, where as of late, traders more and more have used Uniswap as a way to access liquidity, despite it being totally decentralized and being owned by no single one person and relying totally on smart contracts, because of the ease of use of, you know, decentralized applications, and also because of the fact that decentralized applications often allow users to more easily access the long tail of the crypto asset market, while Coinbase, for example, it may be harder for certain users in certain countries. And then kind of moving on to the third platform. So for any asset manager, one of the most important kind of metrics one would track is, you know, assets under management, or kind of what we call in crypto total value locked. So an asset manager's work can often be seen by how much assets under management that asset manager has. You know, Blackstone is well known for having $1 trillion worth of assets under management, and that's why it's a leader within the space. In a similar way, we can see the fact that Yearn Finance, which is an up-and-coming decentralized asset manager, has already seen $700 million plus worth of total value locked, which is analogous to assets under management. We show that many different investors and many different users are willing to trust these decentralized asset management platforms and have gained a lot of value and yields from using such platforms. And then finally, moving on to Aave, as I mentioned before, the decentralized lending platform. Aave currently, it swings a little bit, but currently has nearly $1.2 billion worth of total value locked to assets under management, which once again show that users are willing to use decentralized applications and decentralized lending on a daily basis, and it serves a real use case. So despite the fact we still think DeFi is a very early space and there's a lot more potential to come, we hope these metrics have shown that even currently DeFi is quite useful and shows quite a lot of product market fit, despite the fact DeFi as a phenomenon has only existed for a year or two. And now I'm moving to a bit of the slide to show a bit more about why we see Ethereum and DeFi as such a gigantic opportunity for crypto and for Ethereum in particular. So this chart kind of just shows a bit of a good scale between the total gross market value of Ethereum and Ethereum DeFi and the total value locked in Ethereum and DeFi, and plus the tokens that have been issued on Ethereum. And then we compare this to the gross market value of the OTC derivatives market in the US. And kind of the OTC derivatives market, kind of according to the Bank of International Settlements, has a gross market value of around $12 trillion, while Ethereum DeFi tokens have a have a gross market value of around 50 billion. And we believe that over the long term, Ethereum and the DeFi movement will continue to capture a larger chunk of the overall derivatives and financial assets ecosystem. And over time, we can see this 50 billion, you know, at some day go to 500 billion and maybe even go to in trillions of dollars. And kind of at that scale, we believe that Ethereum will be well, very well placed as the digital oil in this DeFi ecosystem to capture a lot of that value. And this thesis and this kind of simple market size and example is kind of integral to understanding why we're so bullish on Ethereum as part of our long-term thesis for crypto assets. And I just want to pass on just before we move on to Q&A and kind of wrapping up this presentation, a really good quote from Andreas Antonopoulos, who's one of the leading thinkers within the Bitcoin and crypto asset space about why Ethereum is such an important innovation and why we think DeFi in particular makes the case for Ethereum so much stronger. He says, the Ethereum platform enables developers to build powerful decentralized applications with built-in economic functions. While providing high availability, auditability, transparency, neutrality, it also reduces or eliminates censorship and reduces certain counterparty risk. Crypto has always been about finding new ways to build financial instruments in an innovative and transparent and open way. And we feel the recent innovation around Ethereum and DeFi is perhaps the truest example of this. And really long-term, our thesis is that DeFi and Ethereum will continue to gain real user traction, as we've shown in previous slides, and continue to present a very important investment case. And just to wrap up, kind of the best way to access or get exposure to Ethereum currently, and by contrast, also the wider DeFi space, is through the 21Shares Ethereum ETP, AETH, which is available on Swissquote today. And if you have any more questions about how to get access to our Ethereum ETP, please feel free to ask Chris or any one of us, and we can kind of give you a bit more information about how Ethereum works, how one can get access to Ethereum as an investment class, and also a bit more about DeFi. I'll pass it back to Hany so he can lead the Q&A session before we wrap up. Thank you.
Thank you, Lanre. Thank you, Ellie. We would love to open it up to any questions from the audience, any of our attendees. We're very happy to field any inquiries that have anything to do with crypto, Ethereum, or DeFi. Chris, do you know how do people answer questions? Ask questions. Do we have a list?
Yeah, absolutely. If anyone wants to ask any questions, please feel free to put them in the chat. I don't know if you have access to the questions. I can certainly see them. So if they come through, I'll give you a shout. But perhaps I can kick off, Hany, with the scalability of Ethereum. And obviously, we're going to proof of stake perhaps early next year. There's obviously been network congestion, the first being sort of 2.5 years ago with CryptoKitties. And then we've seen a bit of it over the last couple of months. How manageable or how scalable is the DeFi industry on the Ethereum protocol? And, you know, should we be looking out for other protocols? And hence, perhaps, is 21Shares looking at maybe even thinking 2 years out, creating a couple of new certificates for Protocol X for the DeFi space?
That's an excellent question. So, personally, I don't think that there are many instances historically where good technology hasn't been able to scale to meet unbelievable demand from the other side. If you believe in technological innovation and you believe in things like Moore's Law, we can fix scalability. Scalability on the network today is far greater than what it has been historically. There are far more applications, there's far more assets, there are far more participants in the network today than it's ever been. And like you alluded at the beginning of your question there, there are a few upcoming fixes, and let's call them upgrades to the Ethereum network structurally that will make it even better. That said, there's obviously a huge need for building applications on top of blockchains, which Ethereum today is the best way to do that, is the best platform to do that by far. So it is Ethereum's race to lose, I feel. However, there are a bunch of other very well-funded, well-intentioned potential competitors. Some of them include things like Tezos or Cosmos or EOS. We have a couple of ETPs already for a few of them, and some of our baskets include what we call platforms. And so you're able to just buy the market for these platforms as well. So if you choose to buy an index strategy and you just believe that blockchain applications are going to be a very big part of our future, you can also buy the market or bet solely on Ethereum in our case.
And by buying the portfolio of blockchains, is that effectively tying into the price of EOS underlying tokens and the price of Ethereum tokens and so on as a basket? Is that how you've structured it?
So we go a few steps deeper than that, because we really want to offer something compelling for the end investors. Through a partnership with Signum, which is a Swiss crypto bank and startup, we released the Signum platform Winners ETP, whose ticker I believe is Moon, M-O-O-N. And the formula for that is a little bit more than just the market cap of, say, EOS versus Ethereum. It actually dives a lot deeper into things like the number of transactions, the hash rates, in some cases, the number of GitHub commits, of the amount of code reviews that are and code pushes that are happening, so that you can bet and allocate more towards a network that has a greater developer sense, a greater developer activity. And so I think that has about 10 elements in it. It can fluctuate, predominantly going to be the big assets, obviously, but this is a way for investors to simply make a thematic bet on blockchain applications and platforms overall without making a specific bet on Ethereum by itself.
Makes sense. And perhaps for some people who don't have that experience, it's also an easier way into the market and a more straightforward way into the market.
Absolutely. And a bunch of these assets are income generating through, it's quite complicated, but through a process of mining called proof of stake, that's quite difficult to do on an individual level, but we also do that for you. And so Tezos today, Cosmos today, a few other assets tomorrow, including Ethereum, will start having these call them dividends, income generation, et cetera. We already collect the income generation, the staking rewards on behalf of the investors, and return it to them on a daily basis. And we do this for the assets that have staking today already. So it's a way for you to make both a thematic bet on platform applications overall, as well as generate some dividend type income generation. All by buying a single share of stock. And we'll happily do the rest.
Sounds easy.
It's very hard, but we make it easy on behalf of the end customer.
Easy for the end customer, exactly. And that's ultimately what it's all about. So there's a question come in there. Basically, how easy, or perhaps it should be how difficult, is it to actually transact on DeFi at the moment? You know, do you have much experience, or does any of the team have experience of that?
Absolutely. I mean, I think we're a bit of a nerdy team, so we've been playing with DeFi before it was cool. The really short answer is it's never been easier than it is today, which is part of why the usage is really blowing up. Coinbase now has less transaction daily volumes on average than Uniswap, which is a decentralized exchange. However, it is far from the level where we think it needs to get to start being, you know, a network that in number of users really rivals something like WeChat or PayPal or some of the other, let's call them consumer-centric payment or financial applications. So we've done immense progress just in the past year, just year to date. The things, the tools that have come out have been fantastic, including a couple of things that we are working on ourselves that will release soon. But overall, still much to come, which if you want to take the positive spin on it, it's really amazing that we've reached 15 billion in total value locked on such, relatively speaking, more rudimentary tools. I wonder where it will go once we have some better user experience and user interfaces.
Yeah, absolutely. Feel free to pop your questions into the chat, guys. We're more than happy to challenge Hany as much as you can. But in the meantime, I'll ask him another question.
And Chris, I totally can't see any of these questions, by the way. So you have to get them. I don't know where to check it. My questions are blank.
Great. I'll try and make them even more difficult then. Tailor everyone's questions. But in terms of where 21Shares is going, if you could wave a magic wand and bring 21Shares into the future 2 years ahead, where would that be? Where would you be in this ecosystem? And how will this ecosystem really look?
So 21Shares makes crypto more accessible through allowing it to be purchased on stock exchanges, which means that you can put it in tax advantaged accounts, you can put it as a security, you can have it fit within the same bucket as your stocks and bonds and other things. Our main focus has been on creating more compelling products across more geographies with more optionality. That's really all that we seek. And so putting in a couple of years forward, I think we will still be more of a passive manager. We want to build the building blocks, which is why we have the most expansive product suite by far, so that investors can then go and safely, reliably, cheaply be able to have a stake in the crypto ecosystem. We would foresee additional geographic expansions, and something that we're working on that we're super, super excited about for even hopefully later this year is more income generating products. So there's already the ability, one of the top competitors to Ethereum is this thing called Tezos. And already it gives you an annual dividend that annualizes at a rate of between 5% and 7%, which in our negative yield world is actually pretty exciting, in addition to all the compelling technology that you'd be able to invest in by being a part of that. So we are thinking hard, and by thinking hard, I mean we are actively working on 4 or 5 different products that we intend to release later this year, or early next year, that will be hopefully a sigh of relief in our negative interest world that we're seeing, or zero interest world in some countries that we're seeing, so that you can have income generation, you can invest in technological growth, and potentially also bring more real world assets to the blockchain. And so it doesn't just have to be about Bitcoin and Ethereum and blockchain native applications, but what does it look like when we bring real world assets to the blockchain and then make it accessible to anyone with a Swissquote or brokerage account?
Yeah. And I mean, in terms of real world assets, what do you really think they're coming quite soon? Or from my own opinion, I see quite a few interesting use cases, and I quite often end up turning to startups and saying, great project, love what you're doing from an entrepreneurial point of view. Quite often it's just not there with the crypto element, the tokenization element, and certainly not for us as Swissquote, because we need the volatility of the token to be trading. We don't want something that trades once every year. It doesn't help anyone. So I personally am not seeing a huge amount of use cases. I'm seeing some interesting ones, but not enough yet. So I feel that it's still properly 18 months, maybe 24 months or beyond away from us. I don't know if you've got any thoughts on that.
Yeah, so I mean, I can tell you that we have active plans of bringing a couple of real world assets to stock exchanges by the end of the year. We're actively working on it. On some, we've already, received regulatory green lights, and so it's happening. It's coming. I think it's a very broad question. So the best way of thinking about it a bit is by but by really like understanding that ETFs and ETPs and ETCs are only as liquid as the underlying market. And so it's ETFs do not help with liquidity. They if the underlying or the constituent element is not trading a lot, then throwing it in an ETP or an ETF is not going to fix things. And so something that is, you know, as illiquid as real estate or art will have issues. However, something that we've seen, and I think Lanre touched on there with stable coins, which are crypto tokens that are tied one-to-one to a real world, in Lanre's case, they're a US dollar that is held in an American bank account in New York City that's audited and verified. We know how many dollars there are. It's checked on a daily basis, but you're able to transact it sort of 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. There are no holidays in crypto land. And that is the really somewhat non-intuitive part of this is that by simply putting boring old US dollars or euros or pounds or whatever onto a blockchain and enabling that to happen, you immediately have an incredible increase in liquidity, which we said, you know, doesn't happen with throwing it in an ETP or an ETF, but by putting it on a blockchain, you are able to do that. Our stock exchanges today are closed more hours of the week than they are open. Everything in equity land settles T plus two. Some stuff in bonds and fixed income land settles T plus 40. And there's an illiquidity discount on all assets there. And so I think a big part of that, and certainly what we're interested in as a company, besides being a solid gateway to all these exciting crypto innovations like Bitcoin, like Ethereum, like Tezos, like others that will change finance, is by also bringing real world assets and giving you, generating a yield for you, perhaps without even taking exposure to crypto underlying. And this is going to, you know, change the financial world as we know it. One of my favorite quotes is, you know, banking is a necessity, banks are not. Right. And we're starting to see some of that come to fruition. One of our investors, Anthony Pompliano, believes that, and he famously keeps on saying it, all stocks, bonds, equities, commodities, et cetera, will be tokenized. One of the SEC commissioners just yesterday or the day before came out and said, yeah, of course, all stocks will be tokenized. So this is something that we see coming that is inevitable. And we would love to be a part of it and enable more and more investors to generate yield, reach real world assets, in addition to betting on crypto innovations.
Nice. So there's one more question from Anton. In the meantime, just before that, does anyone else have a last, maybe final question they want to throw in the chat? So Anton said around the fee structures, you know, what are the sort of the average fee structures and how do they compare to the sort of the ETF land in the traditional space?
So we shouldn't compare it to the ETF land because the ETF land tracks things like equities that are significantly easier to trade and custody and insure and all of these things. What we provide is we completely take care of the custody element. We completely take care of staking and so the income generation element. And then we have all of this wrapped in a regulated structure that also happens to be insured, where our custody is actually insured in a policy underwritten by Lloyd's of London, which is a pretty, you know, prestigious insurance fund firm. And so by investing in this, we take a lot of this out. I think the better way of comparing this is by saying, well, how do we compare against buying it physically? From a security and, you know, care of mind, ease of mind perspective, you don't have to worry about custody, you don't have to worry about assets being stolen or mismatched or whatever. On a price perspective, they typically charge on a per trade basis, and the spreads can be quite high, often reaching something between, you know, 200 to 500 basis points, sometimes more depending on the asset. For things like baskets or indexes that are trading on a monthly basis, those fees really add up. What we do is no performance fee whatsoever, a very low, relatively low in crypto land, 1.5% per annum flat fee for Bitcoin and 2.5% for Ethereum and the other complicated baskets. And the reason it is lower for Bitcoin is that as a result of economies of scale and Bitcoin being a little bit more established, things like custody and insurance are significantly cheaper for Bitcoin. So as soon as that happened, we've lowered the price as well. We are looking forward to, believe it or not, lowering the price across the board for all of our elements. But it is what it is right now because of these structural things that in fact are the features of the product. You don't worry about custody. It's insured. It's safe. It's reliable. It fits within the box of what you're already investing.
Fantastic. Cool. And there's no final questions come in. So I guess, are there any last words that you want to share with the audience, Hany, while you've got the chance?
Sure. I think that anyone that somehow has landed in Silicon Valley in the 1980s sometimes will think that it's maybe a little bit too late to join in. And then someone landing in the 1990s will maybe have thought the same thing. All the good electrical components are already over. Oh, all the dot-com era is already over. If you landed in 2005, maybe you would have thought Web 2.0 is over. Judging by what we're seeing now and how every company in the world is rapidly becoming a tech company, this is just the beginning. And there's a reason these assets have an exponential increase. Anyone that has any diversification whatsoever in their portfolio should allocate something towards something that is this innovative and compelling a technology that has the potential of upending a lot of the financial infrastructure that we take for granted today. And whether that bet be Bitcoin or Ethereum or something else, this is going to stay. It is going to change the financial world as we know it. And we are so early. I think this is like the internet in the 1980s. Or early 1990s. It's so early and it's going to be so exciting. And we'd love to constantly be your guide and your bridge into this exciting world.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. Well, I think there's a very big lesson there. So early certainly is one of the key things. And obviously there's plenty of access to the crypto world, both with Swissquote and with 21Shares. So please feel free to check them all out. In terms of the web, this being broadcast and available on YouTube, I believe that will happen. Stefano is the man usually to do all that. So you'll certainly get an email and you'll certainly get further access to this. Thank you very much. Any questions, please feel free to reach out to the 21Shares team or myself, and we look forward to speaking to you again. Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you, guys. Bye.
Bye, everyone. Bye.